This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Okay, so thank you very much. So the end of the last time was we discussed in the complex structure modulized space of W, and it had a special scalar geometry. That means, in particular, I can write down a scalar potential in terms of the periods, where this is an integral over W. And then I had picked the symplectic basis of A and B cycles. So they were in H3W of Z. And we were, so to say, starting to calculate the periods. And we made the following observation. First of all, they are inhomogeneous coordinates on the modulized space, that is by the local Torelli theorem. And then I could write them by going to inhomogeneous coordinates, putting one coordinate out. I could write them as in this form in terms of this prepotential, which this prepotential is a holomorphic function now of the inhomogeneous coordinate T is xi over x naught, and then we had here dt f. So all these formulas are the indices I can run from 0 to h to 1. Run from 0. Yeah, that's correct. So I runs from 0 to h to 1. And correspondingly, we have h to 1 of this t's. I don't give the labels in this table, but of course, it's clear that there will be H3 periods. The prepotential, I mean, if I come from a Calabi-Yau, then it always exists. I mean, if I start from a supergravity point of view, there might be a situation where there is no prepotential, but in the geometrical setting, I don't have to worry about this. Yeah, there's a discussion by von Breuen that n equal 2 supergravity does not strictly require a prepotential. Of course, we don't know whether these theories are sick for other reasons. So, for instance, if you start with a Riemann, if you start with Seiberg-Witten, then you have this positivity condition on the metric, and this positivity condition they don't worry even about if they say there is no prepotential. So it's not clear that this series are consistent. So let me then introduce also a basis A, B in the cohomology, a dual basis. So this should be a dual basis. And the one formula I owe you was the one for the scalar potential in terms of the periods. Now I can write omega as xi alpha minus fi beta. So these are just the expansion coefficients. And then, of course, I can write k as being minus I log xi fi minus xi fi. So, well, now I can plug this into this formula, this expansion, use that it's a symplectic basis, it's a dual symplectic basis, and then I get this formula. Now, the next part of the lecture is essentially explaining you how to calculate the periods, so how we calculate the periods.
Okay.
Yes?
Are you missing just a bar on the
right? Yes, a bar, thank you.
The
I,
I,
I is actually here. No. Is this true? Yeah, this is true. So this quantity, of course, is real, and therefore, if you take the bar, then you have to have a real function. That's why we need this I. So how to calculate? The periods on a Calabiau. So I mean there is it could be that you have a particular cycle which you can directly integrate, but this is actually the exception. So usually the determination of the periods falls in two steps. First you derive a differential equation for the periods, which is called the Picard-Fuchs equation. And then of course this solution to this differential equation are arbitrary linear combinations. And then in the second step you worry that your particular linear combinations are actually corresponding to a basis of cycles in H3MZ. So you have to make sure that they correspond to actual cycles in the Calabiau. So the first step is is relatively simple. So if you take a derivative with respect to z, then you get some function of z times omega, but then you get also a piece which is a, well, if this was a 3-0 form, then this is an element in H 2-1 m. And in general, you can you can convince yourself that whenever you take a derivative with respect to various coordinates, let's say there are many coordinates of the period, then you end up in the space H, let's say d minus n, where the sum runs from n from, let's call this k. So this runs from 0 to the maximum of d and n, where n is actually the sum of all this ni. So if you take, essentially if you take n derivatives, then you end up, then you the cohomology is farthest away from the cohomology of this guy. Of course, omega was in h d comma 0 m. So the cohomology that you reach, which is farthest away from the holomorphic 3-0 form, is then d minus n d minus n comma n. Now, of course, this is a finite space, and that is, if you take arbitrary combinations of these derivatives, you expect a relation between the derivatives. So therefore, we expect a relation of the derivatives in cohomology and that becomes a differential equation on the period. So in order to actually do that is not, well, I mean, this can be cumbersome to actually find this relation, but the idea is basically by an observation of Twork and Griffiths. So remember that our omega could be explicitly given as a cycle of 1 over p mu, where this is a holomorphic differential in the ambient space, and that is a cycle which goes around p equals zero. So by this residuum expression, we could give our period. And now what Twork and Griffiths tell you, that the following is actually exact. So if you take the derivative with respect to p, and you take r plus 1, and then you multiply it by mu, and then you have dk f pr mu, then this is exact. I mean, this is an exact form if the following is homogeneous of degree zero. So this is the coordinate of the Calabi-Yau. So p will be depends on x and on the moduli, but x is the coordinate on the Calabi-Yau on the Calabi-Yau space. And now if this is homogeneous of degree zero, then this is an exact form. And that actually helps you in deriving this relation, because if you take derivative with respect to the to the modulus, I mean, let's remember that, for instance, for the quintic, we had the following equation. So this was the modulus, and then the x were the coordinates, and this all runs, of course, to 5. Then if you take in this form derivatives with respect to z, then you would generate higher powers in p. And if you can reduce the power of p by this formula, then you get finally back to your omega with some coefficients. And these coefficients are precisely the coefficients of these linear relations here. In practice, you have to use algebraic computer programs like Macaulay, because this calculation, even for the quintic, can take 2 pages. If you have a more complicated situation, it will quickly go out of hand. There are also other tricks to derive the periods, which I will say a little bit later on, based on the symmetries of this expression. You can also derive the Picker-Fuchs equation. But all told, I will give you the answer for the example of the quintic. So, or the quintic mirror. And now this modulus is z. So we have an operator that annihilates the period, which is given by the following expression. And so this thing annihilates this period, which is a function of z. And here this theta is conveniently the logarithmic derivative of this period. So that is what expresses this relation that I have, well, that you can derive, for instance, by the Twork-Griffiths reduction method. if you find it under this name. So then you can ask yourself, I mean, you can now make, let's say, search a solution. So what would be the properties of this solution? So what you will do is you will make, of course, a power series ansatz. And in this power series ansatz, you introduce a parameter alpha. And of course, in general, if you plug this in here, then you will find that you get an equation that alpha c naught has to be zero, for the higher for the higher c's, you will find a recursion relation. So you find that c n equals called Cn equals Cn minus 1, and then the factor is 1 over n to the 5, and then a product of 5n plus m, where m runs from 0 to 4. And of course, in this case, you get a solution if alpha 4 equals 0. And then you can immediately sum this up. So you get that this is 5n factorial over n factorial to the 5. Now, the problem with this nice solution is that you will find one power series, but you will certainly find no other power series. And that's basically because this equation has only one root, a degenerate root of order 4. So in this case, you will not find other power series, but you can find new solutions by noting the method of Frobenius. So, well, the alpha is just in the ansatz, so we know that the leading power, it can be, for instance, a square root if there's a monodromy of a square root, so that could be 1/2. So I so whenever you try to solve a period equation, you know that the periods can only degenerate in a certain way, and therefore even if you don't know anything about periods, if you solve a differential equation, you would make this ansatz, because it could be that it's a power series, that there's a square root in your power series, or a rational root, or whatever. You just make this ansatz, and if, for instance, if this would be a polynomial of alpha of degree 4, which has distinct roots, then you get immediately four independent solutions. That's why you do it. But so to say, if the roots are degenerate, then then you have to make another ansatz basically, and the method of Frobenius tells you how to make the ansatz. So the Frobenius method is very nice. It says basically what it does is, it writes the solution that we found. So the solution So basically, the idea is simply that wherever you had an n in the solution, you replace this with n plus rho. And now you notice that that if you take a derivative with respect to rho on L and then set rho to 0, that this commutator actually vanishes on the space of solutions. As a consequence, you can now construct a number of solutions, because you can say, okay, let me define x naught as being this omega z of 0. That's the solution that we already found, because then the gamma function goes to the factorial there. And the other solutions I just find by using that I can first take the derivative and then apply my differential operator, and it will actually commute, so that I get, for instance, x1 is 1 over 2 pi I, and then you take the derivative of omega z rho, and then you set rho equals 0. And if you do that, then you get 1 over 2 pi, then you get x naught multiplying the log of z. This actually just comes if the rho derivative just hits this one, And then you, then all the coefficients stay the same and give x naught. And then there will be a power series, let's say S1 of z. So this is a normal power series, which just comes, this will be, contain the the psi function, the derivative of this of the gamma function, and is determined simply by this formula. So now you can get a third solution, and this you just do by taking the second derivative of omega z and z rho to zero, and then you get 1 over 2 pi squared, and then you get x log squared plus 2 S1 log z plus another power series. All that comes just. And you can do this a third time. And you get something which starts with, well, let me just write 3, and then it's something that starts with log 3. And I don't write it out. So then the first problem is solved. I mean, you have your differential equation. You have neat ways of finding the solution. What remains is the second problem, namely to combine the solution with so that they actually form an integer basis. So what you already notice if you look at the solution is that if you take a monodromy around z equals 0, then this log here will actually spill out this solution here. So you get actually that x1 goes to x1 plus x naught. So that is an integer monodromy, and that's actually a good sign that you have found an integer basis. But the the problem is more to adapt these guys to integer solutions. And at this point, it is useful to remember that we have mirror symmetry, because mirror symmetry, in mirror symmetry, you cannot calculate the prepotential f with the instanton corrections. But what you can do is actually to calculate the prepotential f in the large radius limit in terms of classical intersection numbers. And this information about the classical intersection numbers can actually help you, and the form of the period. So if, let's say you know the prepotential, at least the classical terms of the prepotential, then you could adapt at this point all these two periods in order to match this expression, and that's exactly what you can do. So we know from mirror symmetry there will be a variable t, and we know that this is minus omega a, which omega b, which omega z. Remember that this was the basis of the Kähler cone. So this is just the classical intersection number now on M, and then we have this combination. And in order to, well, I mean, there's a 3 factorial. In order to, if you take the derivative, you just end up with the intersection number. And there are further terms, A B T A T B, which are also given by classical intersection, as I will say in a second why how. And then there is a term which is 1 over 24 C2 times omega A times TA. So this is also a classical intersection term. Thank you. And then we have a quite famous term, which comes actually in the A model from the for loop contribution of the sigma model. So this is the Euler number of m over 2 times 2 pi to the power 3. Well, this is just a constant. And then we get instanton corrections, which we don't know in the A model, but which we will know once we have matched the classical terms to these solutions. So then if you now plug this in to this, I mean, now you first have to construct the mirror map. So the mirror map is indeed that T is identified with x over x naught. And the motivation for that is actually also comes from the from the A side, because if you change the B field by an integer value, then you know that an integer shift of the B field will make all the T's to T plus 1. And you see these T's that are the quotient of that with these solutions here have exactly this property because of this shift here. Now you can say a little bit, and that means that all these logs here will actually be converted to powers of T. and that means that you can fix the log terms, and that means that you can fix the solution. So another way of saying is that remember that in the modelized space of Calabi-Yau, we don't have the global Torelli theorem, we don't have a global picture. So I rely on the fact that I find some special points in the modelized space of the Calabi-Yau about which I can say more things. And in this case, what the characterization of this point is actually that it has maximal unipotent monodromy. So we search a point of maximal unipotent monodromy that is if I take this cycle around z equals 0, consider the monodromy. I call this monodromy mz naught, and it will transport my period vector like this. It's a linear transformation on this period vector. And you see that this, because of the logs, it is maximal unipotent in the sense that if you take mz naught minus 1 and you take some power, then this power is actually the degree of the manifold plus 1. And that is the highest power that can be needed in order to make this quantity 0. So if you have a point which is none of maximal unipotency, then you would have can live with a lower power. But at this point, and this actually comes from the log structure, you you find that that you have to take the power of the dimension of W, the real dimension of W, the complex dimension of W. So this is simply 4 in this case. Now the next step is once we have found an integer basis, then you want to know the discrete symmetries that acting on the modelized space of the Calabi-Yau. And so what are the discrete symmetries? So the discrete symmetries will be actually the monodromy groups and And we can say the monodromy group is generated by monodromies like I wrote them here. And there's one group which is, let's say, which is H21. And this is in SP H3W, comma Z. But this is certainly by mirror symmetry multiplied by another group, H11, which, however, I calculate, of course, as SP, as a subgroup of SP H3M of Z. And then I know a little bit more. There will be also mirror symmetry, which exchange these two spaces. And that is basically replacing what I had in the simpler cases. This replaces this O DD Z of the of the K3 and T2 example.
Now the mirror symmetry really exchanges two different spaces, and before it acts with
a... Well, I mean, this is a trick because this is a trick because I'm saying we have in the Kähler modulized space I have a monodromy group in the complex structure modulized space I have a monodromy group, and I assume that the monodromy group of the Kähler, of the complexified Kähler structure, just can be calculated by mirror symmetry. But in fact, it's the group on the same space,
yeah,
just on the...
This I don't have object, but to multiply the whole thing with the mirror symmetry itself.
Yeah, okay, there you're right, actually. I think...
For the torus, it's okay, because it exchanges...
Yeah, you're right. I mean, actually, I used mirror symmetry already. Let me just do it. So this is the monodromy group that I know. And so this would be all only the case if I have indeed self-mirrors.
Yes.
Like, for instance, the Enriquez Calabia or something like that. So then I know the... Well, I mean, I have to tell you how to actually compute this monodromy group. And of course, the first monodromy we got, so to say, for free, because we have this classical intersections, and this classical intersection already determined the monodromy around z equal 0. In fact, if you are not I mean, if you want to prove mirror symmetry, you can also derive this alone in the complex model, complex structure modulized space by analytically continuing to other singularities and check that there is an integral base of monodromy. But let me now, for simplicity, assume that we know that and calculate the full monodromy group. Let's see the full monodromy group. So the full monodromy group is, well, I mean, first you see that if you look at L a little bit more sharply, then you find that at 1 minus 5 to the 5 z, the highest derivative of this so this is the fourth derivative of this operator, actually vanishes. So you know that something terrible must happen with this differential equation if you set z equal 1 over 5 to the 5. And that is actually the conifold point. So what you see, if you look at at the equation for the mirror quintic, so that if you set, well, I mean, this was xi minus z minus 1 over 5 product xi. So you see that at this point, dp dxi can be 0 if all the xi are equal to 1 and z is equal 1 over 5 to the 5. And in addition, of course, P is equal to 0. Now you can analyze this point a little bit further by saying, okay, you take a variation from this point, let's say, with epsilons, and then you make a change, let's say u linear and epsilon. Then you will find that locally this equation looks like u1, u2 minus u3, u4 equal equal mu, where mu is z equals 1 over 25 plus mu. So this is again a linear perturbation away from this point, and that is the Konifold singularity. And you know that at the Konifold singularity, you can analyze it, and you find that an S3 cycle shrinks. And if just one cycle shrinks, then even in three dimension, the Lefschetz formula holds that Dave has used yesterday. So in other words, if I look now at the cycle, let's say C, and I want to see what happens if you go around Z equal 1 over 5 to the 5 with your monodromy, then I know that C goes to C plus the intersection, the symmetric pairing of the intersection with this vanishing cycle, which in this case is nu, times the vanishing cycle. Now you have only to figure out which of the periods vanishes, and it turns out it's the period which is maximal in the logarithms. So so you can see that m z equal 1 over 5 to the 5. So if you, I don't know, if, yeah, so it's this period that vanishes. And well, it depends, of course, how I walk around this cycle, but let me put a minus here to be in a consistent notation. Then you get all R1, because it's a symplectic basis. Only one is actually dual to this vanishing cycle. And then you get, at the third position, you get a minus 1, because this is at the third position. This is the one that vanishes. And in fact, it's the one that vanishes which corresponds to the D6 brain, because you can associate to these cycles. Well, I mean, since the mirror map on the A side is something like B plus E of an area, you can say this is the D0 brain. this corresponds to the D0 brain, this to the D2 brain, this to the D6 brain, just by looking how are the powers in the logarithms, and comparing them with the volume on the A cycle, and that would be the cycle which correspond to the D4 brain. So now you find that there is another monodromy actually at Z equal infinity, but since M H21 of the quintic is just P1 minus this 3 points, z equals 0, 1 over 5 to the 5, and infinity, you already know that this, so if z equals infinity, then you know that the monodromy at z equals infinity will be just the monodromy at z equals 1 over 5 to the 5 times the monodromy at z equals 0 inverted. Because you just can loop around to get this monodromy. So this fixes now. So we have found generators. We have found the generators of the monodromy. So let me now come to. And further interpretation of this. I mean, of course, we had, I told you before that we can calculate the gauge coupling and the masses as exact amplitudes, and the gauge coupling in n equal 2 comes already from the Kähler potential, from the metric of the Kähler potential, because the kinetic term of the vector multiplets also contain the gauge coupling. But what is with the masses? So with the masses, what are with the masses of the BPS states? And you see that if you, I mean, you look at the formula for the BPS state, there's a central charge in this vacuum of this BPS state. And the central charge is actually given by the particular charge vector. So this is gamma is in the charge lattice. And now you can, similar like here, you know everything up to the instantons. You can actually, if you have a brain as an object with a KCE as an object in the derived category of coherent sheaves with a KCE charge, then you can figure out what are at least the classical. I mean, of course, this is all geometrical concept, so you have to see what happens in the large volume limit, and that you can do. So you can actually write this as minus e to the, this is the Kähler form on m, so it's an integral over m, and then you get the charge of this object A, so A is basically the brain that you're looking at is an object in a derived category with a certain KCV charge, and then you get the tot of T, well, just the tot class of the manifold M. And so mirror symmetry gives you all these leading terms, and now you can compare these leading terms, and you will find a rational that they are coming in this. I mean, it's basically this formula gives you, for instance, this thing, and it gives you this thing. And the leading terms you find by identifying the D-brain charges on both sides, and this formula, the periods as explicit function of Z, gives you, so to say, the instanton corrected central charge, which is very important if you consider stability conditions away from the large volume limit. So the next lesson is, of course, the most famous lesson, that if you take the solutions that I have now all provided to you and expand simply this function using this mirror map, then you get all the instanton correction at 0, 0. So let me just write this statement, maybe. So of course, we identify the period vector at the point of maximal unipotent monodromy with the mirror map as an object of the A model, and read from that the instanton contributions. So if you write simply f that you can calculate in terms of z, use this mirror map. So this, of course, are functions of z. Invert this function, and you write it as z of t. Then you get the mentioned classical terms that are written there. And now I focus on this second term, which is the instanton term. So you get an n, and it will be genus 0 contribution, beta. Beta is in h2mz. I mean, now I interpret this in the A model on the mirror manifold M, and get a Lie 3 of q to the beta. And q to the beta, well, I mean, for the quintic, it would be just
e to the 2 pi I t times d. So because, well, I mean, this is always a lattice for the quintic is one dimensional because this is only one Keller parameter, so it's labeled by this one integer, but in general it's of this form. And now you can calculate these things. So you calculate the n0d, and you find that, well, if d is 1, 2, 3, then you find, then you get answers. And these answers are very explicit. And they just come from the differential equation that I solved for you after inserting the mirror map. In fact, this is for g equal 0. And then in the remaining part of the lecture, I will tell you a little bit about the higher genus. So you can also do that, and the first one will vanish, and this starts actually with the same number, which you can find. So what is the mathematical situation on these numbers? I mean, these numbers, they were proven to, well, I mean, first they were calculated by Konsevich with localization. And this was systematized by Gibbenthal and then Bong and Liao. actually, Bong is his first name. Lian and Liao. And then these numbers, this was, I think, in 97 or something. And these numbers, they were proven in the A model by Singer. I think this was in 2008. So, I mean, these physical predictions actually can make mathematical sense of, and I will talk in a second about it. But okay, let me make a little bit of another topic. I mean, we have said that by the SYZ conjecture, in principle, we can construct the mirror manifold, but it's not effective. what I do in order to get all these calculations done, I need always the mirror manifold. So let me talk a little bit about construction of mirror manifolds. So we had the quintic mirror, and if you write the generic quintic, so a polynomial of degree 5 in this 5 homogeneous variables of P2, then you find there will be, of course, 5 monomials like this, and then there will be 20 monomials like this. So if they are different, then you get, well, that's 20. Then there will be 20 monomials like this. So they are all monomials of degree 5. Then there will be 2 times 30 of this type, let's say xi, xk. And then there will be another 30, which are of of this type, xi, xj, xk to the 3, and then there will be 20 of the type xi, xj, xk, xl, and then there will be finally 1, which is just the product of them all. And so you see there will be 125 monomials. And what I have done in order to get the mirror, I have basically take the quintic and divide it by a group set 5 to the 3, which is defined as sending xi to e to the 2 pi I over 5 n, let's call this k, nk, xk, where the sum of the nk is 0 mod 5. And you see that that this group actually leaves you from all these monomials only this which are invariant and this which are invariant. And that is the reason that we worked for the mirror quintic with this polynomial constraint. But it also induces some singularities. And if you, so this is actually V singular. And if you want to have V, then you have to resolve the singularities. And it's actually a simple toric exercise to see that, V is V singular resolved. And you can easily check that H1W go then to 101. So this has been systematized in toric geometry. I mean, this counting of these monomials actually can be related to counting of points in a Newton polyhedron. And the the resolution, since they are all. Yeah?
If you sum it up, you get 126.
Oh, sorry. I forgot this one, I think. So, yeah, I mean, the. So basically, this is of course is of course correct because you have to divide by the by GL5. Well, I mean, you have to divide by the isometries of this P2, which leaves the constraint invariant, and this subtracts 25 parameters. So you get actually, indeed, you need this. So you get 101 in the original. Thank you. So the a relatively broad answer of this type of question was given by Butterev and then even generalized by Butterev and Borisov. And the answer is given in terms of the canonical section of toric ambient spaces. So replace the P2. At the P4 of the quintic by some more general toric space, and you get a very well known among physicists combinatorical formulas for a huge class of mirrors. So this is Butterev, and if you want to have it more from the physical side, you can read a review by Max Kreutzer in 2006. And actually Max Kreutzer, of course, and Harald Skarke, they classified all this polyhedra that Butterev, from which Butterev shows that construct mirror manifolds, at least in the sense that the Hodge numbers do exchange. So what is Butterev says? He says we need this point counting, so he introduces reflexive lattice polyhedra. Let's call this lattice gamma. And what means reflexive? So so these are convex hulls of lattice points, of integer points. Including the origin, and such that which are bounded by hyperplanes of dimension distance 1 to the origin. Origin, and that means basically there is a primitive vector in the dual lattice, and then all the points in the polyhedra have well, all the points in the polyhedra lie on this one side of this hyperplane defined by this dual lattice. And then, so what is a Butterworth constructs then reflexive pairs. Of reflexive lattice polynomials, polyhedra of lattice polyhedra. And well, I mean, these are things which are reflexive lattice polyhedra. So they will be, so X is in the extension of this lattice. And then X. Y is greater than minus 1. Well, if you talk about the hyperplane, maybe I should just put it like this. So here is, so to say, left of the hyperplane and right of the hyperplane if Y is in the dual lattice polyhedron, in the dual lattice. And what, well, you can easily see that if you do this two times, then you get the polyhedra back. And now what he, I mean, the main, now you consider, well, this by toric geometry, I don't give too much detail, will give rise to ambient spaces P, P delta. So, well, you can, for instance, for the quintic write a simplicial, easy lattice polyhedron and its dual and see that everything works. And then you call it X delta and X delta the, the hypersurface in the canonical so this has automatically a first Chern class zero and then Butterworth gives a beautiful formula so he can now everything is combinatorial just like before we counted these points and like in this construction, which I don't have make you explicit, you would count also points of a toric diagram which describes the canonical resolution of this Gorenstein singularity. You get that this, that the you get the following very nice formula for the Hodge numbers, which obviously is symmetric if you exchange the two polyhedra. So it's H of lambda, and then is minus one dimension of this polyhedra, and then it's minus the sum of all the interior points in codimension one, codim one faces. And so this H means that you count all the points in the polyhedra. This H star means that you count the interior points in the polyhedra. And this basically is what subtracts you this reparametrization group of the ambient space. So that is, that's why you don't have it. And then you have an interesting correction formula, which goes over codim 2. So delta is then codim two faces, and well, it's delta star, and then you count h of this. So this has, of course, a dual face in this original polynomial, and you count the sum over codim two faces in delta star, and you count of the dual multiply it with the number of interior points in the corresponding dual face in delta, and you see that this formula is simply invariant. So if you exchange delta and delta star, then you exchange also H11 and H21. And and this part is proven. So you have a huge list of examples. So let me use the last minutes or last, well, actually last hour, half hour to say something about the higher genus. So from a mathematical point of view, there is a one canonical approach, which is the Gromov-Witten invariant approach to calculate these numbers. And but this is not necessarily the most efficient approach, even from the mathematical point of view. So let me tell you a little bit more about how the higher genus topological string invariants are related to BPS invariants, which can be associated to the modelized space of stable pairs at the end. But I, of course, will tell you the story from the physics point of view and essentially tell you how to calculate these BPS numbers. So the higher genus invariants. So you might consider a generalization, and I will actually make a little bit of an interesting generalization even from the point of view of the topological string. So I consider a generating function which is organized as follows. So this depends on the scalar modulus and is a sum of s from 0 to infinity and g from 0 to infinity. Now the we first see that for the topological string, we recover is given by setting epsilon 1 to minus epsilon 2 times igs. And then this term vanishes, and you get the usual topological string expansion. So you get f gs t is then g equals 0 to infinity, and then gs 2g minus 2 f 0g. So in particular, F00 is our old friend, the genus 0 invariance is the prepotential. Counting now you can write this actually as, well, you can write all this f 0g as, well, there are also classical terms, but then you can write it as a sum just r beta g beta in h 2 mz q beta. And then these are rational numbers, which are the Gromov-Witten invariants. So this R, B, G, they are they can be actually calculated as an integral over the modelized space of maps to M in the class, which have genus G and which end up in the class beta. And this is a theory which is in general is a positive dimensional space, only whose generic dimension is zero. So therefore, you introduce a virtual fundamental class, which also depends on G and beta and M. And then you find a number which you can actually calculate by localization. I mean, that's the way that, for instance, Concevich did it. So you can calculate this, right, this by localization with respect with respect to the toric, to the C star actions of the ambient space. And that should work for all this P delta, if there are enough toric geometries, enough toric symmetries. And this is a complicated calculation, and it can be only done for G equals zero. Now, what happens for the, well, I mean, but it is like that in the Calabi-Yau case, if you look, for instance, at the expected dimension of this modulized space, so if you look at the expected dimension of M, of the modulized space M of M, so this is curly M GB, then you will find that this is actually in the curve class beta C1 of Tm, C1 of M, and then it's something like 1 minus G, the dimension, let's write this form, this is more familiar to me, 3 minus the dimension of M. And you see, for a Calabi-Yau threefold, then this is precisely zero for a Calabi-Yau threefold. And that means, in general, that that these numbers might exist, while if the expected dimension is negative, these numbers usually don't exist. If they don't exist, and if it's positive, then maybe you can calculate some other numbers that come if you put in a more complicated integrand in this modulized space. For instance, if you force the curves to meet certain points, then you can still calculate numbers. But in the Calabi-Yau case, it's beautiful that all these numbers exist, and we want to calculate them, at least from physics point of view. So let me explain you what you expect from the physics point of view. So from the physics point of view, it's not good to work with the modelized space of maps, but it would be more convenient to work with the modelized space of D-brains. So from the physics suggests that we consider somehow the modulized space of D2, D0 brains. And you can see what labels this, more precisely of these D2, D0 brain bounds, BPS states. And of course, BPS states, as we have seen, they are labeled by a charge, beta, in which is in this case just in the cohomology group of Z. So that's okay. That is a charge in a charge lattice. And then there are from the space-time point of view, there are spin quantum numbers. And so of course this also gives you the mass, because these are BPS, and in some sense it's of course from physics point of view completely completely natural to ask what is the representation under the Poincaré group, and then you need the mass and you need the spins, and you work here with the five-dimensional Poincaré group. So it's actually SU2 left times SU2 right. So there will be two indices, J left, J right, and then eventually also the eigenvalue of the third Pauli matrix is M left, M right. So now you can, so you expect a BPS multiplicity. N beta J left J right, and you expect it in particular to be in N properly counted, and unlike this, there's already one advantage against this chromo-fitting invariance, and they should be counted by an index very much like the index that I showed you for the heterotic string, which counts degenerate curves on K3. So it would be an index over the Hilbert space of such BPS states. And then it's M left, M right. And and then it's you take care of all the quantum numbers that you introduced so far. So you have a beta times t, and this q left right would be e to the 2 pi I epsilon left right, and the epsilon left right are actually related by 1/2 epsilon 1 to the epsilon 1s in this formula by 1/2 epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2. So so far so good. You can expect that such an index under certain circumstances exist, and then we can calculate the multiplicities in this form. So what is with reality check of these ideas? So what you can do is you can formally calculate the amplitude, and this is now fulfilling this promise that you can calculate also gravitational amplitudes. So you can calculate from the mirror symmetry setting, you can calculate the amplitude where this is the self-dual part of the curvature 2 form of supergravity, and then it's coupled to the self-dual part of the graviphoton multiplied with epsilon plus, and the self-dual anti-self-dual part of the graviton photon to the power epsilon minus. So this is an amplitude, and this is an holomorphic amplitude, and when you want to know its dependence on the Kähler moduli space, it is expected to be given by this, well, essentially by such an, by the F n plus n minus, let's say. I mean, you have to reorganize a little bit because of this, but essentially by these guys over there. So how do you calculate these things? Well, if you would know the n beta j left j right, you could do the calculation, because it's a simple stringer loop calculation. And that gives you a very interesting expansion of this guy. So the Schwinger loop calculation tells you that if you know the mass of this BPS state, then you can actually apply just quantum field theory and calculate the amplitudes. And the amplitudes will be like this. So there will be an integral. So this is essentially the integral that Schwinger did in order to calculate the magnetic moment of the electron. And it is minus 1 to the sigma left 3 plus sigma right 3. So these are the Pauli matrices which read off the spin. And then you get e to the minus s of the mass squared. The mass is given by beta, by the charge lattice, so you can associate it to some, and you can associate everything to these quantum numbers that I have written down there, and then you get s this third spin number, and then from the denominator of the Schwinger loop you have something like 4 sinh hyperbolicus epsilon 1 times sinh hyperbolicus epsilon 2. Turns out you can do this integral once you would know what are the multiplicities of the states, because they fall all in representations of SU2. Then you need here the quantum numbers of the representation of the SU2. You need the masses, and that are just given by the three indices that you get. And well, it's a pretty impressive formula that you get. You get the following product formula. So it's nicer to write e to the f, and it's given by the following product formula. It's a beta in hmz, and then it's j left, j right, from 0 to infinity. Then it's the product of m left, m right. So these are the spin quantum numbers. So they run indeed from minus j left, j right, to plus j left, j right. And then there is a sum over two integers, m1 and m2, from 0 to infinity. Well, actually, they go from 1 to infinity. And then it's like 1 minus q left m r, m q m left, like this. Then there is this factor which takes care of the mass. And then there are some extra factors which and then this is all determined by the assumption that we know this number. So these numbers should appear here. They appear, in fact, in the denominator. So they will be here. And they come with a little sign, minus 1 to the 2, j left plus j right. So it's a beautiful formula which would give you all topological string amplitudes. In fact, even the ones which are the refined topological string amplitudes, if you would only know the multiplicities in this index. So you have also have to say that in the Calabiau case, you have a little bit of a problem with this index, because in order to make this index to be well defined, you need, I mean, in general, if you put epsilon 2 unequal to 0, then q plus actually does not square to 0 anymore. So you have you lose one of the BP you lose one of the BST operators, and in fact, in order to have it, you need an U1R symmetry by which you can twist this supersymmetry generator. So you need a U1R symmetry. However, this U1R symmetry can only be present if the Calabiau has a has a U1 isometry. And of course, we have seen that H10 of a Calabiau is 0 in the previous lectures if it's compact. So you have to resort to non-compact Calabiau in order to make this index well-defined. And I consider mainly the anticanonical bundle over some Fano variety over this Fano variety. This is a local Calabiau, and this is a two-dimensional thing with a line bundle over it, and this line bundle has the required U1 isometry. So in this case, this index makes actually sense. So let me just finish by writing you the essential structure equation which determines this FG. And so this is now, well, I mean, since I, in the last 10 minutes, I can talk about a little recent work. So this is a work with Huang and Kashani-Pur. And it actually determines this BPS invariant. So it's Mingxing Huang and Amir Kashani-Pur. So the idea, or what we did, is we found a structure equation for the FNG, which is very similar to the BCUV. So it's a generalization of BCUV of the holomorphic anomaly equation of BCUV. So of course, now many people will not know this equation, but I just write it down because it's I have prepared everything. So we have basically this Cijk. This comes from genus 1 data. And then I have the covariant derivative, which also is the connection in this special Kähler modulized space, for which I just have written you down the Kähler metric. And then it's in g minus 1. And then there is a sum, mh, and it's di f h, f m h, and then it's m n minus m, g minus h. And there's a prime, that means that m n should not be 0, 0, and should also not be n is this mix, okay. So the so this is the equation, and in fact for genus 1 you find, so this is, this holds if g plus n is greater than 1. And for genus 1, you find the following. Mn, and then minus chi minus 1 over 24, where this chi is the Euler number of the manifold that you consider. So these are equations which actually can be solved. So I have to do this on these manifolds because I wanted to actually have the full dependence. And that means we have to take local mirror symmetry. Then this is a non-compact case, and this has been studied very well. Then W goes to a Riemann surface. And I take this Riemann surface to be of genus 1 to simplify things. And then omega, the 3 form that we had, gets to a meromorphic differential. So, yes? I think I can almost finish in time. So let me finish with the following formula. So now this is the genus 1 curve, and as was also mentioned already, in the genus 1 curve you can bring it into Weierstrass form, and let me introduce an object which which befits this situation. So this would be this coefficients that you know from the Weierstrass form. They will depend on the complex moduli, and then it will be written in terms of the Eisenstein series. And it's actually should be of weight 0. So these are the famous Eisenstein series. So E to N are the Eisenstein series, basically the G's that, the big G's that were in Dave's lectures. Apart from this Eisenstein series 2, which is not quite a modular, but you can make it modular by taking the normal Eisenstein series 2, which is not convergent. but you can make it convergent by a certain procedure which introduces you an imaginary part of tau.
So now you see that this one is a Dibar derivative, and this Dibar derivative will in principle only act on this imaginary part, because as everything else is holomorphic in this equation. And that has the consequence that the f ng can be written as 1 over this discriminant of the Riemann surface. So the discriminant of the Riemann the discriminant of the Calabiau was 1 minus 5 to the 5 z. This is the locus where this thing gets singular. And then it is 2g plus n minus 2 of the z, and then it's a power series in this x, and here the power k goes from 0 to 3g plus 2n minus 3. So this is the unholomorphic generator, and then there will be some polynomials in which also depend on n and g and will depend on z. But these polynomials have a finite degree because this object has to be regular, and that means the degree of this polynomial, and actually the only one which is interesting for us because the rest are given by the recursion relation, is P0g, and the degree of that is given by so high that if is bounded so that if you take z to infinity, it doesn't exceed the degree of this discriminant factor. So it's is simply given by 2g plus n minus 2 times d delta, where delta is the degree of this discriminant in z. This is all degrees in z. The Riemann surface has only one parameter that I have to worry about. Now that means that this function can be now calculated once you fix the coefficients in this finite degree polynomial in PGN, and that you can actually do by looking at the Konifold boundary condition using again this formula, because at this, if you at the Konifold, you know what happens. There's one state becoming light, and you know how the the degeneration is. And in fact, you see, whenever this is a generic discriminant, then all its zeros of it will lead to conifolds. That is, if the degree is high, then I have more zeros, and therefore I can also fix more polynomials. If you do the count coefficients in the polynomial, if you do the counting, you will see that this is completely integrable, and you can, for instance, for P2, you can fix all these numbers. And yeah, so with this, so this is a challenge actually to calculate them by any other means, maybe by by means of algebraic geometry. That would be, if this epsilon 1 parameter is 0, then you consider stable pairs of sheaves. And there's work by Pandrea Pande and Thomas. And recently with Sheldon Katz, I investigate how you can calculate them by algebraic means, these numbers that we have calculated, nor this ng. Okay, so let me thank you for your attention. And
thanks a lot for this nice lecture. Quite impressive how much information you put into the last lecture. So, so I guess there are quite a few questions, so please go ahead. I think you can take another few minutes to answer questions. Even more impressive if you don't have questions.
Yeah, I mean this is a point. If you this data you know from Seiberg-Witten curves, basically the meromorphic differential and the Riemann surface, and you can in particular calculate with this holomorphic anomaly all Nekrasov partition functions. In fact, you can do better than Nekrasov because you can consider curves
which have not an action description. So one of the big things in n equal 2 series at the time when Seiberg and Witten discovered a new n equal 2 series was that there are n equal 2 series which don't allow for an action description. Now, in this case, you cannot do the instanton calculation of Nekrasov, but our situation is that whenever there is an action, and we have done this for SUN with arbitrary number of flavors, then our answer fits Nekrasov's partition function. If there is not an action, then we have predictions. We can yet not check these numbers. So that's why I'm mostly interested in the situation of local P3, because there the numbers are non-trivial already. I mean, for instance, for local P1 and so on, this is more or less trivial. But then I have things that I can check the whole structure of modularity, and that's what that's why I'm interested. I mean, it's not so clear how to check n equal 2 series without action. But as I said, when there is an action, then this just, after a shift in the masses, actually just reproduces Nekrasov partition function and reorganizes Nekrasov partition function in terms of modular forms, which is also a nice thing.
Are there some additional, maybe more basic questions?
Basic questions.
Please go ahead.
On the previous board, you had that expression, depending on epsilon 1 and epsilon 2.
Yeah.
It's not
okay.
So is that supposed to exist for a quintic, say, or not?
Yeah, I mean, the point is, I would say, for the quintic, this is not an index, and therefore, well, I mean, I think the numbers n, I mean, the whole thing in this expression is to define these numbers n, b, j, left, j, right. And we know from the quintic that this actually is not an invariant number. So if you change the complex structure of the quintic, then you change these numbers. I mean, there can be easily given examples where this is the case. And therefore, I would say, and the reason is basically because I don't have this U1R symmetry, which doesn't make, so that is not an index for the quintic, and therefore it could change. And
but the expression should exist.
The expression in principle should exist if I fix a particular quintic with a particular complex structure, but I don't.
There is an expression, it's just not invariant.
Yeah, it's not invariant under complex structure deformations.